This teaching is part of a response as well as an engagement on issues pertaining to race, racism, discrimination, but we look at it in context of the ongoing political campaigns, especially we have an election coming up next Tuesday. And the content of the political discourses of this current presidential election, as well as many other seats, have heavily utilized racist discourse, demonization of communities of color, immigrants, and projecting the problems that exist in American society again on those who are marginalized and least powerful politically in order to reshape the political map moving forward. But also thinking about race in relation to our campus and issues pertaining to UC Berkeley and the UC system, we tend to celebrate diversity, and if you walk around campus, you will see more images of people of color on posters than in the classroom. Or in positions of influence and importance, and that is a fundamental problem when diversity is used as a PR instrument rather than a fundamental value that informs every aspect of the campus and curriculum as well as leadership. I'm still struck when we look at the rank of tenured faculty on this campus is still predominantly and overwhelmingly made of white faculty, tenured faculty, and predominantly also white male faculty in essence. And that is something that has not shifted fundamentally, at least from the 1990s up to the present. Some departments still is part of the zero club, departments that don't have faculty of color. Or if they do, they have a quarter, and I'm still trying to find out how you get a quarter faculty. This is, again, in a free-floating stage, so you could actually only have a full human being. And therefore, we also need to critique how statistics are made to actually hide and shield the reality of what is occurring, because if you actually look how we break this picture, it is actually highly distorted on our campus. So we wanted to discuss how the America's racial imaginary and complicated in relation to election cycles. California has been often the test lab for many of these racial political campaigns. Again, we had Proposition 187 that started the whole anti-immigrant discourse. And in the state of California, at least, Democrats were as much responsible for the anti-immigrant discourse as Republicans. We tend to fail to recognize some of our Democratic leadership stood in front of the border and having ad campaigns that promoted the anti-immigrant sentiment. Similarly, in here, we had the assault on affirmative action with Proposition 209 that many of us were at the interjection of trying to put a counter narrative and a counter pressure on affirmative action and how to think of affirmative action. And then in general, all the different complications that in relation to three strikes or out, and that's something that the state of California was the place that began the whole process of three strikes or out that criminalized a large number of the African-American community and Latino community and began the whole prison industrial complex that is highly racialized. So we have to really intertwine the political campaigning and race because it's paramount. It's one of those permanent wedge issues that continue to be with us time and time again. And then weaning into this discussion, hopefully we'll get to questions about gender and issues pertaining to our current presidential candidate who keeps thinking that sexual assault is something that is of a locker room talk, even though that he was not in the locker room, nor was he an athlete. He was a 59-year-old man that is using a discourse that is highly misogynistic, highly sexist, and continued to promote this. And that's not only that, the people who went on TV to defend this, which shows you that the impact in our social imagery relative to gender issues, relative to misogyny and so on, has filtered and become almost normative. So hopefully some of those discussions and some of those questions that will arise. Our hope is not to come up with a solution in here, but to have a discussion and hopefully to generate further movement for sustained effort to change the conditions that we are. Education is about transformation. I firmly believe that education is about social change and social justice, and to bring about the transformation in the conditions, both on campus and across the society. Now, knowing that both Yula Taylor and Rabab are not here yet, so I'm going to ask for Michael Cohen from African American Studies Department to come and begin the process for enlightening us and having the discussion on this important teaching on America's racial imagery in election cycles. Would you please welcome Michael?
Thank you to Professor Bazian and to the panel and everyone who's here today. It is an honor to speak before you. It is the teaching season, and I'm proud to be a part of this. I'm going to give a version of a talk that I gave on Sproul, but because we're not, there aren't Trumpists shouting anti-Semitic things at me, I should be able to focus here, so that would be a little bit easier. But I mean, to benefit from the absence of the Trumpists, I have slides, I have illustrations that go along with this. I realized I cheated, I already had my talk, so I made a PowerPoint presentation to go with it. But let me just begin this way. The poet Claudia Rankine, in her book Citizen, writes of the following: Black people are dying because white men cannot control their imaginations. And this vision, right, of white people possessed with a certain understanding of who people of color are, what their place in our society is, and that leads to and justifies a particular form of violence, whether that is police violence, whether that is military violence, whether that is the violence that we're seeing increasingly on the campaign trail, seems to be a dominant theme in American political life at the moment. And it's something that I want to take on quite directly in this talk, which is to talk about whiteness and the history of whiteness and what the history of that racial formation, right? Because we need a very basic level that whiteness is a race, right? Whiteness is always in crisis. I have, as a white man, have as much race as anyone else. And whiteness is constantly in a state of crisis, but never more so, I think, than now. And the consequences of that crisis are what we need to actually be able to grapple with. So let me just begin here by saying that the 500-year-old world historical process of white racial supremacy is coming to an end. Slowly, incompletely, necessarily, whiteness is ending. Now, this is not to say that in the future we will all be beige or all tan everything. There will always be white people. And in this, we have to understand the difference between white people and whiteness, which is the same as or similar to the difference between black people and blackness, right? Now, what I'm saying then is that the global hegemonic racial project of white supremacy is slowly coming to an end. Begun by Columbus, seen here, lost in the Bahamas in 1492, and fueled by indigenous genocide, African slavery, and capitalist accumulation, white supremacy created an ideology of biologically defined racial differences. In this vision, white Europeans, specifically white Europeans, were understood to be scientifically rational and militarily powerful. They were perceived to be naturally superior then to the darker races of men. And these are examples of racial typology from the early 20th century. So much so that the designation of humanity, or man, is understood simply to be white and, well, naturally male. Whiteness serves thus as the unmarked subject, the normal, the fully capacious form of a universal humanity. Now everyone else, what women, people of color, queer, or gender nonconforming, the disabled, or others, get forms of discrimination and a hyphenated identity. And these images, right, are more trying to get you the five races of men, but really, if you look at it, they're about the sartorial. Right, the white guy with the beard in the middle is fully clothed, the African is half naked, the Asian is giving you crazy side eye, scary, inscrutable side eye, whereas the others wear animal skins and have painted faces, right? It's a vision of racial hierarchy established in the early 20th century as a vision of white supremacy. This was and is, of course, a myth. Race as a biological theory of history is simply false. We are all equally members of a singular human race, myriad in its diversity, yet one in its common destiny. But race and racial stereotypes are no less consequential for being fictional. In 1790, the newly independent United States of America granted citizenship to all, in the terms of the law, free white persons of good moral character. Now, it's, like it says, it set a two-year residency term to establish that moral character, and it explicitly refused citizenship to Native Americans, to indentured servants, to the enslaved, to free blacks, to Asians, and others. Which means that the national identity of this new nation was typified or codified by race from the very beginning. American national identity has always been white. With the racism embedded at the heart of indigenous dispossession and chattel slavery, the vision of biological race emerged to explain why millions of people could be held in perpetual bondage in the land of the free. How can you have millions of enslaved Africans in a country dedicated to the Jeffersonian principle that all men are created equal? Well, it turns out to be rather simple. Those Africans, it turns out, are not men at all. They are members of an inferior race, biologically incapable of self-governance, property-holding, and self-possession. This was the attitude established by Thomas Jefferson and the other members of the Founding Fathers. I would recommend to you at this point reading notes from the state of Virginia in which Thomas Jefferson determines that race is some biological inherent determinative of superiority or inferiority. It's a biological theory of history. In the words of the historian Barbara Fields, she writes, quote, "American racial ideology is an original invention of the founders as the United States itself. Those holding liberty to be inalienable and holding Afro-Americans as slaves were bound in the end by holding race to be a self-evident truth." Or as Ta-Nehisi Coates writes, "Race is the child of racism, not the father." White supremacy endured in the United States of America after the Civil War, forced expropriation in the form of emancipation, and it shaped the world history in the form of imperialism and colonialism. Yet it was with the Second World War that the expanding tide of white supremacy reached its peak and shattered. It cracked against the gates of Auschwitz and in the flash of atomic fire over Hiroshima. The evil committed in the name of white supremacy and the Enlightenment could no longer be denied to the world. And a global wave of liberation from European powers spread over the post-war world in the form of decolonization, civil rights and labor movements, feminism and sexual liberation, movements that begin after World War II and continue to this day. Now, while it is naive of us to have ever imagined that President Obama could bring an end to 400 years of American white supremacy, it is equally cynical to suggest that his presidency is not some sign of our progress, evidence of the all-too-slowly improving race relations. But Obama's election has not forged this change alone. The Obama era has seen the rise of new social movements that are forcing us to change our language and to see the world in a wholly new way. The Occupy movement demanded sort of economic justice for the majority of Americans, setting the tone for the Bernie Sanders primary success. Marriage equality has been achieved, and the fight for LGBTQ rights, civil rights, continues to expand. Immigrant rights activists and dreamers have forced a new discussion on citizenship and immigration, and the Black Lives Matter movement has powerfully changed the conversation around race, policing, and human rights. So taken together, multicultural democratic party rule, an increasingly liberal popular culture, and an expanding wave of radical social movements has left white male heteronormativity feeling threatened and decidedly diminished. From the Obama family sitting in the White House to Colin Kaepernick kneeling for the national anthem, the symbols of American power and national identity have been usurped by people the founding fathers would never have recognized as human, let alone capable of citizenship. And I think what's interesting is we read these two images against each other, that one, we could see that there's actually tremendous diversity in terms of black politics, that there's a sort of radical wing that is struggling against symbols of patriotism, and then there's this sort of centrist democratic wing represented by the Obama family itself, it's literally sitting and living in the White House. Now, from one point of view, this shows a diversity in black politics, but from the other point of view, it shows, from the right-wing point of view, these are one and the same image. Each are both equally destroying, diminishing, reducing the substance of American national identity. This singular issue, whiteness and American national identity, offers the best explanation for why the right-wing opposition to Obama dressed up in Revolutionary War garb and called itself the Tea Party Patriots. Right? It's a return to origins of white nationalism in the US. Donald Trump thus first staggered into presidential politics on the back of the Tea Party by pressing the racist conspiracy theory that Obama was born in Kenya, and by pressing this into the mainstream. By pointing to Obama's race without naming it directly, Trump and the Tea Party sought to strip the president of his sovereign legitimacy and to deny the legality of his election based upon the crime of his racial identity. During the primaries, Trump took this white nationalist base and used it to conquer the Republican Party. White supremacists or white nationalists, those who define themselves defined as those who claim a white identity as biological evidence of a racially superior blood, bodies, and civilization, have formed the core of Trump supporters from the start. With the selection of Steve Bannon of Breitbart News, Trump invited the alt-right to effectively take over and lead his campaign. And alt-right, I think, is the sort of online clan, the kind of current form of internet neo-Nazism, etc. In fact, the single leading indicator of support for Trump is to ask if you think Obama is a secret Muslim. While 54% of Republican voters think that Obama is a Muslim, some 74% of Trump primary supporters believe that Obama is a Muslim. 76% of Trump primary voters also supported his ban on Muslim immigration and denying Syrian entry to the United States of Syrian refugees. Thus, it is no joke when Trump supporters talk about deporting the president. And if you look at the data here, I'm happy to share this with anybody later, that these are opinion polls in which basically they're asking Trump voters, do you think that white people are more intelligent? Yes, overwhelmingly, than people of color. Do they have a better work ethic? Overwhelmingly. Do they have better manners? The white people are more mannered than people of color. Overwhelmingly, Trump supporters believe this. That black people are more violent, they believe that overwhelmingly, and that they have a lack of commitment to lawfulness, that they're criminals, overwhelmingly. So the data that we can see from all of these opinion polls show that Trump voters are quite literally defined by their bigotry. Of course, when Hillary pointed all of this out, calling half of Trump supporters, quote, a basket of deplorables, that same liberal media forced her to apologize for the generalization, despite her, in fact, underestimation of the actual sociological facts at hand. In fact, probably two-thirds of Trump supporters would fit into her basket of deplorables. Now, she is expected to adhere to the basic rule of politics, which says that you can insult the other candidate, but you're never allowed to insult the other voters, especially if the voters are white. Now, because Trump can call Mexicans rapists, tell African Americans they live in hell, and demand that good Muslims turn in bad Muslims, those are being his terms, and Trump has never been forced to apologize for insulting those voters because we understand that the voters are white. In fact, Trump insulting Mexicans, Muslims, and others is simply what passes for him as, quote, telling it like it is. So in a sense, like, even the liberal media and the Clinton campaign simply just fell for that whole framing that says, well, you can insult all the immigrant voters and non-Christian voters you want to, but if you actually go after white voters and call them out for being racist, then you're going to have to apologize. So even the liberals in this sort of capitulated to that framing of what's going on here. But make no mistake, white racial resentment is one of the key factors driving this election. And that this resentment, this sense of loss or mourning on the white right, this sense of being strangers in their own land, is in fact deeply overdetermined, meaning that it has more than one cause, simple demographics being one of them. And this is where I pause to recommend this book to everyone. I think it's flawed, but it's actually quite important. It's good for all of us to read by a Berkeley sociologist, Arlene Hochschild, who moved to Louisiana and did an ethnography of Tea Party members. It's a fascinating book. Again, flawed, but nonetheless very much worth a read. So yes, we are familiar with the fact that in the nation's kindergartens, white children are now a minority. That in California, white people are no longer a demographic majority. And that we know that one day in the early 2040-something, a brown child will be born in Oakland or New York to the Bronx or wherever, and white people will no longer have a majority of the population in the United States. Now, this is the demographic figures as estimated. This is how Fox News covered this story, right? White Americans losing majority under 5, right? The sense of loss that if brown people are winning, then white people are losing. Now, here's the other question. What does this have to do with Obama? Why do you have a picture of Obama with school children? Like, this has what to do with Obama? You know, he has two kids. It's like, it's not like he's the source of the overpopulation. But yet, right, this is the sense that, right, white people feel like they are losing their country and they know who to blame, right? Now, we can also see, if we care to, that red state white Americans have been suffering deeply since the start of the Great Recession. Not only do Tea Party red states suffer from higher rates of unemployment, infant mortality, and toxic pollution, but a startling survey reported in 2015 revealed that older white American men are dying off at an alarming rate. That in fact, this demographic, virtually alone in the overdeveloped world, seems to be dying in increasing numbers due to unprecedented levels of suicide, drug addiction, alcoholism, and overdoses. The life expectancy of white men has declined by nearly 4 years since the early 1990s, the only demographic to see such a decline. No wonder Trump supporters speak in such apocalyptic terms, because for millions of older white men, their world is quite literally ending. But demographic changes are not enough. They never will be. The end of white demographic majority does not mean the end of white supremacy. After all, this is exactly what the Trump electoral campaign stands to prove. Minority white power governed apartheid South Africa and colonial India for centuries. Nothing says it cannot happen here. White supremacy will neither end on its own, nor will it end quietly, and violence is always available in its defense, as it has for the last 400 years. In the end, we are the only ones who are capable of holding Trump accountable, and this is the 538 estimates as of 6 o'clock this afternoon. We're the only ones that can hold Trump accountable. We must defeat him at the ballot box, and defeat him in such large numbers that Donald J. Trump himself will be forced to admit defeat and acknowledge that he does not always have a winning temperament. But even if Hillary wins, even if the Democrats take the Senate, and even if they take the House, white grievances and patriarchal authority will not simply go away because its most overt champion happens to lose an election. White supremacy may prove yet again to be more durable than our democracy. And this is from 1925, but this could be our future. In conclusion, during the second debate, this is the best photo of the entire campaign. It's gross, I'll let you dig it for a minute and then I'll change it. During the second debate, Trump complained that he was being interrupted by the moderators, a white woman and a gay white man, calling them unfair several times. Yet after the debate, the clock had Trump and Clinton speaking for nearly equal time, which shows us something about white male privilege and what the future of our politics is going to look like. For someone used to a life of advantage and privilege, egalitarianism and equal treatment can feel like injustice, like something is being unfairly taken away. This is not about facts, it is about feeling, and that is why Trump, like whiteness itself, is impervious to fact-checking, impervious to scandals, impervious to accusation. This is evidence that whiteness remains enshrined in our political culture, and why Trump has damaged our democracy for decades to come, even if he loses. This is, in the end, what we are up against, not just a single candidate, but against the fictions of white supremacy itself. We cannot win this fight in a single election, but we can most certainly lose it. And nothing less is at stake this November 8th. Thank you.
Next, if I could get Professor Evelyn McConnell Lim, professor of the grad school and founding director of Center for Race and Gender. For those who are able to make it Thursday, we have a celebration for the work and the contribution of Evelyn in the being the founding member of the Center for Race and Gender, having really led many initiatives, including really providing a space and a home for the Islamophobia work that I have been doing. Without her support and her embrace of the center, much of the work that we have done would not have been possible. So please welcome Evelyn.
Okay, so how many here are really, really sick and tired of this whole election? Yeah, okay. I've already voted. So I'm hoping not to think about it. But I have to admit that sort of the what sort of scares me and should scare a lot of us is that apparently a significant portion, you know, at least 40% of the electorate is sufficiently racist that they would actually go with a maniac. And often it's not despite his racism, but precisely because of it, and that he really speaks for them. So I decided that in order to avert a possible stroke on my part from my, you know, kind of rising blood pressure, I would in fact try to tackle head on the main engine of that toxicity. And here I'm going to be repeating some of what Michael has said, namely whiteness, about whiteness and the structures, logics, assumptions that maintained white racial hegemony. And I'm going to, my talk is a little bit more historical. I want to, you know, thank Michael for setting the tone. So, as Michael mentioned, news analysts keep emphasizing that the largely white male supporters of Trump are angry and hurting. They no longer have access to well-paying jobs, to affordable housing, and they feel their children are not going to be even able to do as well as they are. And that these Trumpists direct a lot of their hostility to the federal government, which and its policies, which they see as uncaring about them and their interests. And they take out their anger on racial and religious minorities, often seeing them as unfair competitors and recipients of government handouts. Now, liberal commentators, in the meantime, point out that white resentment is misdirected, because the real cause of white middle class and working class economic displacement is unregulated and predatory capitalism. So the solutions that have been suggested include increasing taxes on the super rich, passing laws regulating the financial institutions, increasing support for social programs, infrastructure rebuilding, and the like. These are all solutions that I agree with, but to me, the issue that still remains is white racial privilege and anti-black, brown, yellow, red racism. And for the term racism, I like to use Ruthie Gilmore's definition of racism as, quote, the state-sanctioned or extra-legal production and exploitation of group-differentiated vulnerability to premature death. Now, that's a little bit of a wordy thing, but I think the idea of death, I think, is very important. The vulnerability to death is the thing that characterizes racial minorities. And certainly during difficult economic times, white hostility and racism rises. However, even in good times, it never seems to completely go away, so that it's always there to be aroused when things go badly. So let's start with the beginning with our country's origins. Very briefly, the U.S. was established as a white settler colony. Now, settler colonialism differs from classic colonialism in that the aim is not just to exploit the resources and peoples of the colony. Rather, its goal is to occupy and gain sovereignty over the land. And this goal can only be attained through elimination of the native peoples who already occupy the land. Now, much of our conventional history has treated white settlement as a single event, something that occurred in the past and has no relevance today. I mean, we're having a national holiday that's coming up, you know, the Pilgrims and the Indians, and that just sort of happened in the past. This is a big mistake. Settler colonialism established structures, self-identities, legal regimes, et cetera, that continue to form the backbone of our society. Patrick Wolf once said that settler colonialism is a structure, not an event. Now, what were the motives of the white settlers? Supposedly, at least according to our founding myths, they were seeking greater freedom and equality than they had in the old world. However, they only sought freedom and equality for themselves, not for those they considered others. And as it turned out, the freedom and equality among settlers was built on the non-freedom of non-white others, whose liberty was completely denied, as in the case of chattel slavery, or severely constricted, as in the case of bonded servants, contract laborers, or those laboring under debt bondage. In short, the labor of indigenous people, Africans, Mexicans, and Asians, was needed to develop and cultivate the land that the settlers took over, to build the infrastructure to extract resources. However, they were not seen as fully human, rather they were simply laboring bodies, and as Michael noted, never as equal citizens. Okay, to repeat, the intent of British settlers and later other European settlers was to take over and occupy the land that was taken, that was already lived on by others. Now what does this mean? It means eliminating the indigenous peoples who already lived here. So the US settler state was founded on violence, not only official warfare, but importantly on extra legal killing raids conducted by local militias and mobs. And such unofficial raids were particularly likely to involve indiscriminate slaughter of women, children, and the elderly, the burning of native villages and crops, and the taking and selling of native women and children as slaves to be sold on the Caribbean market. Now, I think very often people don't realize that Indian conflicts involve the enslavement of Indians, because a lot of them were in fact sold in the Caribbean, although in California, they were actually used as slaves. The federal government rounded up indigenous peoples and herded them on long forced marches, and I'm sure many of you have heard of the Trail of Tears, and where they were confined to reservations. Settler colonial scholars thus describe the successful settler state as being established through what they call foundational violence. And white settlement of California was no exception. Two recent books document the indiscriminate killing of native Californian men, women, and children that the International Human Rights today would call genocide. And you can see this in the titles of the books. There's Brendan Lindsay's Murder State, California Native American Genocide, which was published in 2012, and Benjamin Madley's An American Genocide, the United States and the California Indian Catastrophe. These studies indicate that 90% of the Indian population of California were killed or eliminated during the 19th century. Now, I'm kind of curious in this audience whether any of this history was taught to you in high school or elementary school. So this is the other thing about foundational violence, is that there is a deliberate forgetting or erasing of that memory. So historical amnesia is also a condition of settler colonialism. And I would argue that many of the most fundamental themes in US history can be linked to settler colonialism. First, American imperialism. American settler colonialism was fundamentally an empire-building project. And once the Western frontier was reached, the control of the U.S. had to be extended into a Spanish settler colony, namely Mexico, and then south into Latin America, and east across the Pacific, for example, to the Philippines. Secondly, the self-concept of the U.S. as a nation of immigrants, and I'm sure you've heard of that kind of term as a celebration and part of the story of American exceptionalism. This also grew out of the settler colonial project, because in order to populate the land with white settlers, the U.S. was extraordinarily open to new immigrants from Europe, welcoming them, allowing them to vote and obtain allotments of land taken from Native Americans immediately upon arrival and to quickly become settlers and citizens. One of the studies that I looked at was the first California legislature, which it turned out to be made up of men who had arrived like literally 2 weeks before the first legislative meeting. Immigrants from Europe were immediately given voting rights and mining rights and land rights on the same term as same terms as citizens. Third is the belief in American exceptionalism. There's a long-standing premise that freedom is a natural condition of, in parentheses, white men. However, the corollary is that freedom is not a necessary or desirable condition for others. In fact, for many whites, their own freedom has depended on the lack of freedom of racialized others, whether Native Americans, enslaved blacks, and proletarian Asians and Latinos. Indeed, according to white common sense, racialized others must be controlled and restricted because otherwise they pose a threat to white freedom. Hence the expansion of power and rights of non-whites, as signaled by the election of Barack Obama, has sparked white grievance at the loss of control and privilege and is experienced as a threat. Now let me turn to the situation of Asian Americans, which is a topic that Hatem asked me to address. You might guess why. You see, notice anything about me? Anyway, culturally, collectively I should say, Asian Americans are a multi-ethnic group whose histories before and after entry into the U.S. have widely varied. Nonetheless, certain generalization can be made. The most distinct aspect, I think, of the racialization of Asian Americans is our positioning as what I would call eternal foreigners. This foreignness does not disappear even for natural-born Asian Americans, natural-born or nationally-born, whatever, even in the second, third, fourth, or even fifth generation, as long as we continue to look Asian. This extreme foreignness and supposed unassimilability of Asians facilitated the use of legal exclusion. The 1882 Asian Exclusion Act, which was subsequently renewed every decade and then expanded to include the entire Asian continent, including the Japanese, was the first law to ban immigration based on national origin. So while the racialization of Asian Americans has some unique aspects, we shouldn't forget some of the commonalities. For example, we need to remember the degree to which Asians have been and continue to be subject to violence, including mass killings, expulsion, and driving out of urban settlements in the West, particularly in the last half of the 19th century and the first quarter of the 20th. Starting in 1850, with the driving out of Chinese miners from the California gold fields and the seizing of their assets, white American settlers carried out more than 200 so-called roundups and expulsions of Chinese over the next half century. Jean Failzer asserts that, quote, "Surely the term expulsion doesn't fully represent the rage and violence of these purges. What occurred along the Pacific coast from the gold rush through the turn of the century was ethnic cleansing. These ethnic cleansing drives peaked in the 1880s, with Chinatowns in Los Angeles, San Jose, Seattle, and Tacoma being destroyed by white mobs. Faeser was able to document cases of mobs or vigilantes driving out Chinese residents from nearly 200 towns in the Pacific states. Quote, following the expulsions, mobs or vigilantes seized Chinese fishing boats, nets, vegetable gardens, laundries, stores, and homes. Then they burned down rural Chinatowns. Another historian wrote, quote, as with the Indians to whom whites often compared the Chinese, the way such killings were carried out revealed a deep, almost feral hatred. Chinese men were scalped, mutilated, burned, branded, decapitated, dismembered, and hung from gutter spouts. Moving on to the mid-20th century, we can talk about one of the most traumatic large-scale assaults on Asian Americans, namely the World War II forced removal and incarceration of 120,000 Americans of Japanese descent. Now, in this case, I'm assuming that you have read about this or were taught about this again in high school, middle school? Is that true? Okay. That's good. for Japanese Americans, since the days of earliest immigration in the 1860s, we have been the primary target of white hatred, rage, and violence. Within my own community, there has been a tendency to minimize what the anti-Japanese efforts have involved. In particular, concerning the incarceration of all Japanese Americans during the 1940s. There is a word in Japanese, gaman, that is well known to Japanese Americans. Gaman essentially means deal with it, or forget the past and get on with life. Belief in gaman by thousands of Japanese Americans of my parents' generation has meant that the true horrors of the 1940s was hidden away for decades. It was not until an entirely new generation of Japanese Americans started to probe into the experience of their parents and grandparents that had never been told to them that the process opened up, and this process of uncovering that past is ongoing. So what are we learning? It turns out that the removal of all Japanese Americans from the West Coast and their imprisonment in concentration camps during the 1940s was a much more violent episode than was previously known. The official United States government explanation for what happened was wartime necessity. And because of gaman, my own community didn't really challenge this lie. But as historians, many of them white, but also some Asians, have finally pulled the lid off of what happened, we see the unmistakable imprint of white racism and white privilege. In fact, white farmers and ranchers in the western U.S. have been campaigning against Asians, and in this case, Japanese settlers, for decades before the 1940s. And these efforts often involve either vigilante justice or, as a substitute, state-sponsored violence, such as outlawing land ownership by Asians. When World War II started, white racists saw their opportunity. Now they would not have to ride around at night burning people's crops or killing women and children. Now they could have the U.S. Army do their dirty work. In essence, the Army announced a date by which anyone with even one drop of Japanese blood must leave California and the other Pacific states and be imprisoned in large inland concentration camps surrounded by barbed wire and patrolled by armed guards. Failure to leave would involve immediate arrest and prosecution. The U.S. government conveniently brought up neutral-sounding words to describe this period: evacuation, internment, and relocation. But the truth of what really happened, and the government imposed violence against an entire racial group, and the deaths and psychological scars and ruined lives, was a story yet to be told. And it is still being told as we speak, as there are efforts to capture the last remaining stories from survivors. You will undoubtedly note the many similarities between the racism against my own community in the 1940s and the anti-Muslim and anti-Hispanic movements of today. For the racist portion of the white majority, it is much more advantageous to have the government do the dirty work than have to organize bands of vigilantes to ride around at night and set fire to homes and farms, even though that still does occur. And I should say that one of the groups that has been very supportive of sort of anti-Islamophobia efforts has been the Japanese American Citizens League because of that experience. Now, lest you think that violence against Asian Americans has abated altogether, civil rights groups have documented not only continuing violence against Asian-looking people, but even a rise in the last few years as the kind of racial rhetoric has been trumped up, so to speak. Most of you are too young to remember the first nationally publicized case, the 1982 murder of Vincent Chen, who was beaten to death in Detroit, Michigan by a white Chrysler plant supervisor, Ronald Evans, and his stepson, Michael Nitz, who had recently been laid off. Presumably angered by Nitz's layoff by Chrysler due to competition from Japanese auto manufacturers, the two assumed that Chin was Japanese, sort of which raises the bitter point of we all look alike. I should mention during World War II, there were these magazine articles for whites so that they could distinguish between the patriotic Chinese and the sneaky Japanese. I won't have to tell you who looked more noble and handsome in these particular depictions. The two assumed that Chin was Japanese and beat him to death with a baseball bat. Now, what happened subsequently is they were imposed very light sentences, namely probation. And this lack of sentencing or jail time shocked and mobilized the Asian American community. And I think it was really a significant moment for a pan-Asian American movement, because even though it was supposedly directed at resentment against Japanese, it showed that Asian Americans were kind of generally targeted as a whole. A later federal conviction of the two defendants for civil rights violation was vacated. So in the end, neither defendant served any time. Now, what is striking here, and one that I see repeatedly, including in cops' killing of unarmed blacks, and this recent the trial of the Bundys, going in with guns or arms into a national park office, and I was trying to imagine, well, what if a bunch of armed Muslims went and invaded an office, a federal office in San Francisco? Would they be alive, let alone would they get off without any jail time? So what is striking here, and one that as I said repeatedly, is that if a white person fears that a black person, child or man, might hurt him, or if a white person is emotionally upset by, a person of color, it is considered in some way understandable and therefore excusable or exculpatory by white judges and juries, who will then impose little or no prison time. Now, in light of this and other stories I've related, I ask you to imagine what the situation would be if the voter suppression efforts that have been underway are fully successful, thus disfranchising people of color, and only whites would vote, or primarily whites would vote. Mr. Trump would win by a landslide. Truly a depressing thought, but a clear reminder that the facts of white violence against people of color is still a fact of life of America, more than 400 years into the so-called American experience. Thank you.
Thanks, Evelyn. Bring up Victoria Robinson from American Cultural Program and Ethnic Studies. American Cultural Program, many of you are taking courses. This was a victory that was attained by students, so actually both ethnic studies as a department and American culture came into existence because of student mobilization. So don't underestimate the power of collective work and for imagining something different. And what we want in discussing the history of racism and the history of structural and institutional racism is for us to begin to imagine something that is different and then to go out and actualize it. So, Victoria?
Thanks, Hatta. So, I want to pull something up, but would you help me, Michael?
Yeah, sure.
Please, this is your computer, which is great.
Yes.
Could you pull up an image from Julio Salgado? So, quickly, while Michael just pulls up an image for me, I just want to thank Hatta. Professor Bazian has been a leader in the conversations of race and social justice on this campus. And I think that we all know the courage that he's brought in the past 6 months alone to holding the university accountable for having deep, meaningful, and accountable conversations on this campus's relationship to racial justice work. So I just want to... How many of us know the work of the artist behind me? A couple of people in the room? Okay. So this is Julio Salgado, very much known for the work hashtag Dreamers Adrift, the work around undocumented queer, which is the aligning of two forces around challenges to immigration policy and citizenship making in the country, really bringing to bear a kind of pressure of precarity to the idea that citizenship is something that affords a citizenship status that contains freedom, that contains democracy, that claims justice, and to kind of challenge and force open a different conversation beyond borders and beyond the kinds of white heteronormativity that normally centers a politics of respectability. So touching on, I think, what Hatem and Evie and Michael have already kind of alluded to, which is this politics of respectability that circulates around the immigrant being a good immigrant and then containing some sort of forward-looking citizenship status. So there's a lot of threads that I want to talk to that have already been mentioned, but I'm essentially asking in some of my comments, what makes space for this, right? What makes space in some ways for an incorrigibility of politics, for what I think of as a politics of disobedience? Right? And I ask that question because I stand here as a mother of two kids. My first born child is voting for the first time, and we've been having these conversations in some ways about what gets passed on between generations. And many of us stand here because we stand on shoulders, right? And the shoulders we stand on are shoulders that are built between the politics of precarity and the politics of possibility. So I am a bit of a geographer too. I say that because one of my colleagues is in the room, and so I better behave myself with my geographical analysis. But there's some scale I want to kind of twist and turn between, which is to think about what's already been mentioned too, which is the state of California in setting a stage. Last week, I was fortunate enough to have a conversation with a political prisoner in the West Bank, and we were talking about the ways in which Palestinian lives, bodies, and territories have been used as live experimentation. And this is in the context of a classroom where we're talking about the interwoven apparatus of carcerality between mass incarceration, immigration detention, and deportation. And this gentleman at 3 o'clock in the morning, his time, because we have an afternoon seminar here, I think shocked the students in the room by talking about the ways in which G4S and the security forces are able to use in some ways those bodies, those politics, those territories to experiment and then bring those experimentations back to us, right? And those aren't separate national scales, this kind of fluidity of exchange of what it means to try out the politics of control, of isolation, of decapitation, right? In some ways, California is a harbinger of a lot of that kind of racial logic and racial template, and I want to kind of situate our state in that. And I misjudged some of the room, so bear with me. I thought in this room today are many who would be voting for the first time, like my daughter. And yet the political, social, and economic conditions that you'll be voting from were being set in the years surrounding your birth. Now, I ask myself, how am I aware of the Cold War, of the Federal Housing Association, all the kind of things, the prefacing of policy and institutional structure that made me and made my opportunities and that are invisible to my own logics, right? But I want to propose that the conditions of your current voting choices of the electoral map is being set by your birth condition. The mid-1990s between 94 and 96 creates a crucible of new racially inflected and saturated policymaking in California. Of course, we could go back even further in thinking of where our current student voters' social conditions and their racialized landscapes can be found. Because, of course, we have Proposition 13 and the tax revolt in 1978. That'd be a good place to start. Noting its responsibility for the disemboweling of the state tax base for education. That would be a good start. Or we might start with the campaign for governorship of Ronald Reagan in 1965. And it's what we now call, thank you, Ian Haney Lopez, dog whistle politics. For excoriating welfare, calling for law and order, and opposing government efforts to promote neighborhood integration. All key words and phrases planned to appeal to a white electorate by racially coded terms. When elected to the California governorship, Reagan then showed explicit hostility towards civil rights, supporting a state ballot initiative to allow racial discrimination in the housing market, stating, I quote, if an individual wants to discriminate against Negroes or others in selling or renting his house, it is his right to do so. It is then Reagan who, when elected president in 1980, would go on to talk on a national stage about a Chicago welfare queen and her drain on the public system, but also alongside talk about the worker, the taxpayer, who, to quote Reagan, was waiting in line to buy a hamburger as some young fellow, quote, ahead of him, was buying a T-bone steak. Originally, that term was not young fellow, it was young buck. But young buck in the kinds of hyper-masculinization that enforces in the human mind the idea of black masculinity was actually put aside. But we still obviously call, and we can hear the call to white victimization through racial coded rhetoric. But no, we won't start there, because the guess that you get that I'm saying that racism has been at the heart of much California politics making. The winds of which blow across the country, and sometimes they become tornadoes in other states and to the capital. When will we start? We'll start in the womb of those who created our current students. The political womb that was your parents of the mid to late 1990s. In 1993, in the wake of the murder of 12-year-old Polly Klass from Petaluma, a charged racial atmosphere was being developed. Out of personal tragedy in the context of state reduction in social services, public education, maybe we should talk about Proposition 13, and the quick and sharp statewide closure of, in the state of California, 21 military bases within sharp succession, and the attached community housing, employment, and tax bases, political elites found it irresistible to pander to the fears of white California voters, of their fear of what they saw as a vast disappearing future, by whipping up a frenzy of anxiety placed on brown and black faces and bodies. They pinned anxiety to explanations played out around race, namely anxieties about the economy, say immigrant, and anxiety about crime, say urban, mean black America. It's within this context that California voters passed Proposition 184 in 1994, otherwise known, as Hassan's already introduced, three strikes. This California bill was soon followed by what we now infamously know as the 1994 Federal Crime Bill, or to give it its full name, the Violent Crime Enforcement and Law Enforcement Act, which pushes the blow to the current prison system through its toughing crime provisions and the now familiar hyper-policing and militarization of black, brown, and poor America, and of course extended its standing rock to native peoples. Those California winds that were whispers were being felt. Begin to blow towards Washington, and now the whisper is prison industrial complex. Again, on November 8th, 1994, this newly galvanized California electorate votes 59-41% to approve Proposition 187. Let me just say those numbers again. The voting electorate of California votes 59-41% to approve Proposition 187. Now we get really clever with our terminology around propositions. It's called Save Our State. Dot, 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 dash, 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 dot, dot, dot. Anybody know what that is, Morse code? It's the international maritime signal for SOS, right? Save Our Souls. So cleverly, Prop 187 in 1994 is kind of creating this axonomic territory between the idea of literally saving our souls and saving the state. Prop 187 had five major sections, including a ban for unauthorized migrant children from attending kindergarten through university education, requiring that education employees verify the legal status of children and their parents of those, quote, to be suspected of not being authorized, requiring that all providers of non-emergency publicly paid health care verify the legal status of their children and their parents, and in some creating the contradictions that are of the 14th Amendment, solidifying a sliding scale of membership in the country based on race and class axes. The impact of Proposition 187 was that irrespective of people's legal status, our Latinx neighbors and friends felt this proposition personally. It was actually a proposition that was aimed at tearing families apart. For those of us who then and still today live in communities and families that are mixed, and by mixed we mean a combination of legal and documented citizen members like my own, our realities were not supposed to exist. Children were afraid to ask their parents to attend an end of year school concert, ask them to take them to the doctors, and even when eligible for state resources or services, migrant families backed off, fearing what a relationship to the state might mean for the entire family. For the citizen children of migrant parents, the term hereditary disadvantage began to take root as a way to explain the experience of this removal from the state, passed down from generation to generation, independent of citizenship status. And it was also the breeding ground for Proposition 227 in 1998, or the English language only bill, essentially outlawing bilingual education in public schools. In effect, the theory behind California's Proposition 187 was that immigrant policy would affect immigration policy. We in Europe call it the Swedish effect, make life so horrible, so dismal, that of course you won't want to stay. Now we might call it the British effect. That denial of public services, of education, of healthcare, of a future with citizenship, would dissuade people from wanting to come to have a future in the state. This is not what happened, more of which I'll share in a moment. But remember those California winds? Well, they continue to blow. Prop 187's provisions went to the court and were essentially ruled unconstitutional and lacking of due process. But in 1996, just weeks before the re-election of Bill Clinton, the Illegal Immigration Reform, and get this language again, Immigrant Responsibility Act, we're starting to hear neoliberalism in our legislative terms, was passed by Congress. As well as providing for more border enforcement, to date, approximately, and we can take it back to about 1994 with Operation Gatekeeper, 6,600 people have died on the US side of the border. We can't collect figures on the Mexican side that we can verify, and 1,000 bodies are yet to be identified. They're now held in Potter's Field. So apart from providing more border enforcement, it also provided for deportation of those convicted of misdemeanors, retroactively, even when you served your time. And importantly, it gave rise to something that we didn't think we'd see in our lifetime. It's called the 287G program, which empowered local law enforcement officials like Sheriff Joe Arpaio, up for re-election next week in Arizona, to engage in racial profiling and to allow local law enforcement agencies to check the immigration status of anyone who was booked into jail. And so the winds blew, now almost shouting to Washington, immigration industrial complex. This direct democracy idea, which we had a laugh about before, of the California public voting, which means we have to question who qualifies as the public, of taking their frustrations with the legislature of the political process directly to the ballot box, deserves itself some time to unpack, but I'm not a political scientist, and I don't want to do that work. But it rolls forward. And in the national election year of 1996, Proposition 209 is passed, amending the state constitution to prohibit state institutions from considering race, sex, or ethnicity in public employment, contracting, and education. Note that there is nothing dog whistle about this. It's in your face. It's a relentless attack to maintain educational inequality. And as so often happens, there was the law on the page and the effect on the ground. I can only speak from my experience here at UC Berkeley, but Proposition 209 might be said generously to have had a chilling effect on the campus's work with students of color and programs that name that work with students and communities of color. You have only to ask our students themselves to hear powerful first-hand stories. We have never recovered from Proposition 209. It's just here. The message that it sent was that you don't care, you don't count, your experience doesn't count. Not only does Prop 209 mean that our campuses do not represent the diversity of our state, but it means that programs such as the one I'm fortunate to be involved with, which Hatem's called the American Cultures Curriculum, the so-called diversity requirement, had to fight for their original value. Value not in the mode of what we now name as neoliberal multiculturalism, where any analysis of power is taken away and where the value of the classroom experience actually proposes an increasingly commodified outcome embedded in market realities, where the aim at the command of cultural competency or multicultural awareness, or, and this is the current kind of language, ability to lead global strategies through those cultural competencies, in sum, a set of corporate human capital equation, or at worst, protection from lawsuits kind of initiative. In essence, a material, economic incentive to cannibalize people of color histories, and neatly package them for economic efficiency's sake and private gain. No, not that sort of value. What we have to fight for is not a multicultural curriculum or multicultural campuses as a university's public representative, but a social justice education, which counters this instrumentalism and is capable of asking and answering what education is for, which is, perhaps I might suggest, an education that tackles inequality, that doesn't trivialize racism, that doesn't create distance from, but creates intimacy with, formulating and making real justice, and submits itself to challenging the neoliberal economization of education. So many of you, when you were in the womb, or perhaps just out of it, like my own child, the direct democracy of our California propositions blew across the country and set the stage for your generation. What was said in the cause of the political process and the stretch of that process from California to copycat states to the White House and back to our campus had mass effect not only on how we talked about each other, but how we see each other and how we feel about ourselves. And so much has been said about the effect of the debased, vitriolic, hate-filled political season that we have at our feet, but we have been here before when you were a twinkle in somebody's eye. And so I wanted to share that next week when we go to the polls, when we consider our stance on Proposition 57, parole guidelines for those convicted of non-serious felonies, youth sentencing by judges, not prosecutors, is instead of a direct file, but about rehabilitation in juvenile facilities. Then we start to unpack the prison industrial complex that you inherited, which was given steroids by Proposition 184 in 1994. And when you vote on Proposition 58, which reverses the English-only Proposition 227 of 1998, which stated that children could only be taught 1 year in a language other than English, and essentially banned bilingual education. Or when you vote on 64 and the decriminalization of adult use marijuana and the redirecting of funds back into communities targeted by the war on drugs, I think when you vote on these propositions, that you'll be playing witness to and participating in another stronger wind that blew from 20 years ago, and that was massive mobilization, organizing, and politicization shared by generations and cracking open the system. We could state that demography is our destiny, and to look at the incredible dramatic rise in naturalization rates for Latinos in the state after Prop 187. They are incredible. The number of naturalized citizens in the state grew by 24%, or almost 500,000 people in 1 year alone. Remarkable, right? We could then say that our destiny for a just future in a majority-minority state is set, and the country prefaces our future. And yet, I would cautiously state that California's powerful political legacy that you will be participating in shows us that we cannot take for granted our outcomes and that we require constant struggle and mobilization. The policy-making landscape of 20 years ago that created newly embedded logics of structural racism and marginalization that extended from the state also listed new fights, new power, new possibilities inside that precarity. And so ultimately, just as in the past, the revolution will not be legislated. but you now have the chance to vote on issues that contribute to a future that looks like communities with resource schools, green spaces, quality housing, decriminalized public policy, and access to decent healthcare. Vote next week.
Important image after Gloria's mentioning of the prison reform act that was passed in 1984 by Reagan, and we can see the expansion of prisons and the prison population in the United States. California again expanded the prison infrastructure, building new prisons, and with it also come the privatization of the prisons, both in the state as well as nationally. I'd like to invite Munir Jiwa. Professor Munir Jiwa is from the Graduate Theological Union. He's the founding director of the Center for Islamic Studies at GTU. Munir.
Thank you. Dr. Hatem Bazian, and to all our colleagues here, and to you all for being here. I was supposed to be the last speaker, so I was going to just do a couple of sort of examples, I think, that might lift up actual sites that we can think about the racialization, particularly of Muslims in America. So that'll be my focus. I want to focus on one that you probably know was the July 28th Democratic National Convention, where Khizr Khan and Ghazala Khan took stage and spoke. Khizr Khan spoke about his son, Captain Humayun Khan. And the second example I want to cite is Kaepernick and what it means not to stand up for the national anthem, or what it means to kneel in this. The larger concerns I want to raise here are really around the kind of social imaginary, as we think about it in terms of the national imaginary, and the scripts that we're required to perform to become the kind of good citizen or the good American, right? So there are national scripts at play that one has to perform in order to be seen as that good American, and this is especially true for minorities. The case of Khizr Khan is an interesting one. Many of you probably who have seen the DNC performance, really, on July 28th, might recall that Khizr Khan, who is a Gold Star father, his wife Ghazala Khan, Gold Star mother, a Gold Star family are those who have lost family members in wars, took to the stage, and he spoke very eloquently, I must say, about the loss of his son's life. And it was met with applause. And in some ways, on the one hand, we had for the first time a kind of positive sense of Muslims taking a national stage where there was cheer and applause. His wife was with a head covering. There were many women who are usually the sites, the most visible site one can point to, women in hijab in the audience. So this is a very different scene from when Obama, as you may recall, was running, and women in hijab were actually removed from the scene so as to not be seen as too close to Muslims. Now, of course, we can talk about the racialization of why Clinton gets to embrace Muslims, and we can talk about whether she's really embracing them or not, and why Obama had to distance himself, of course, as a closet Muslim. There's a kind of racial politics around that that we can talk about in the Q&A as well. But what's interesting is that there is something going on at the national stage where Muslims are both feared and hated and despised on the one hand, and at the same time be seen as a site for probably redeeming ourselves. So in some ways, to use Arjun Upadhyay's work, The Fear of Small Numbers, minorities tend to be the site where we are both seen as the lack of fulfilling the national promise. So we're always seen as a lack, but we're also pointed to as the place where you can brag about how multicultural your nation is, right? And as a Canadian, we often, for example, point to our First Nations peoples, even though their rights are despicable in terms of our history. So we point to minorities often as both the national pride, when we need to capitalize on them, and they're also the lack of fulfillment of the nation. So they're always the site in which you recognize that there's a lack of purity of the nation. And again, the term purity is loaded, I know, and we can talk about what that means as well. So there's this national sort of moment where Khizr Khan takes stage, talks about his son and the loss of life, and it's a very moving, very powerful, very articulate presentation on his behalf. And part of that narrative is the recognition in some ways, or the inscription of Muslims in the nation as acceptable insofar as his son gave the ultimate sacrifice, right, which is death itself, for the nation. So there's a certain kind of rhetoric that's at play, a national rhetoric, an imaginary in which you're the good citizen or your life is meaningful and it is worth something if in fact you are fighting for the nation. Right, so death ultimately is the sacrifice that one has to make in order to be to be registered as human in this country. And it's especially true of minorities. So this kind of sense of one's patriotism, one's sense of belonging, one's sense of nationality, and one's sense of presence is based on this kind of ability to give one's life. Now notice that the applause and cheer, if you look at the comment sections and you read the sort of all the things that came after that event, one hardly notices the discussion on the war itself, right? So one of the things that we recognize is that Humayun went in 2003 to Iraq, was killed in 2004. Imagine if the script wasn't quite like the one that we heard. What if the script was something like this, that Humayun's father, Khizr Khan, decided that in fact his son was taken away from him because of the military industrial complex in which we live, that he himself and his wife themselves were against the war in Iraq, but honored their son's decision to go to war. Right? Imagine if that was the script. One could imagine it would probably have gotten no airtime. There's very few instances in which we've seen any interviews with the Khan family where there is a talk about why war in the first place. Right? So the starting place itself in this national script is that one's life and giving of one's life to the nation is the place in which you register your humanity as a minority. Right, which is not how we often register others' humanity. And so the minority has this particular task in which to prove his or her patriotism through acts of war. The second example I want to cite is that of Kaepernick and how his not standing up for the anthem, and we have actually many examples of this, Chris Jackson or Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf in the 1996, I believe, wouldn't stand up. He was playing for the Denver Nuggets at the time. Wouldn't stand up as an African-American Muslim. Wouldn't stand up, but he cited his religious beliefs, which kept him from standing up. And that was framed very differently, right? It was framed in terms of Islam as a backward religion, Islam as not aligning with American values, and that seemed to be the rhetoric. And now that we see this same kind of act being taken on by Kaepernick, but through kind of Black Lives Matter, or in his case, really drawing on the Black Panther Party's politics, it's a very different kind of narrative at public. But there are significant overlaps that we need to think about. I just want to read some of the things that Kaepernick said in terms of what he's trying to do with not standing up, but also the camps that he started. So many of you know that just this past weekend, he's had a camp here in Oakland, Dr. Rabab and I were actually at the Black Panther Party's 50th anniversary conference last week, where you also spoke. So there are many things going on right here. And the vitriol he's received, of course, for not standing up is often on people who are saying, well, they don't like his method, right? They don't like the method of him not standing up. And one should be pushed to ask why the method and not his motivation for not standing up, right? So again, the displacement that we see in the Khan story of, you know, of course, celebrating a father and mother who have lost their child, and that's certainly something we should do, but not questioning the war itself. Here you see in the second example of Kaepernick, where there's a sense that we focus in on there are better ways in which he can make his protest. I actually think it's a great way to protest. Here, peace doesn't seem to matter. He's peacefully protesting. He's using his platform. And he is reminding us that there is something called American civil religion at play, where sports, patriotism, the anthem, cheerleading, all of these scripts come together in what is now kind of American civil religion. And we point to these things without asking, well, why is it that the anthem stands in for a certain kind of sacred text or poetry of our nation or song? What are the ways in which one can see their protest or their lack of standing up as patriotism itself, right? So again, the script only shows that patriotism would mean a certain kind of standing up, a singing of the anthem, hand on heart, as we saw. We saw that with, forgetting her full name, one of the gymnasts, who received a lot of vitriol also for not having her hand on her heart in the recent Olympics. And Kaepernick, when he's asked why he's doing this and why he's running these camps, he says these are some of the things that he's trying to do. He's trying to teach young children, and this has a huge impact, and maybe in the Q&A we can talk about the impact this is having on children, as Victoria has already alluded to. He's saying you have the right to be free, you have the right to be healthy, you have the right to be brilliant, you have the right to be safe, you have the right to be loved, you have the right to be courageous, you have the right to be alive, you have the right to be trusted, you have the right to be educated, you have the right to know your rights, right? So these seem like things that we take for granted, but again, with the kids that he's working with, these seem as things that are not given to them as minorities, in which he has to remind them of. Of course, if you read some of the comments online, there's a lot of hate against his very running of these camps. So we see that this is a very divided nation, and events, election cycles have this possibility of bringing out both the precarity, as Dr. Victoria mentioned, and the possibility, right? The worst of the nation, and perhaps, I haven't seen the best of it yet, but you know, perhaps the better of it. And as Kareem Abdul-Jabbar said, in terms of the Kaepernick work, he wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post, and he says, our focus seems to be in the wrong place. And I'll just quote him. He says, what should horrify Americans is not Kaepernick's choice to remain seated during the national anthem, but that nearly 50 years after Muhammad Ali was banned from boxing for his stance, and Tommy Smith and John Carlos raised fists, caused public ostracization and numerous death threats, we still need to call attention to the same racial inequalities. Failure to fix this problem is what's really un-American here. Right? I think it's a significant statement. In the interest of time, I was going to focus a little bit more on Muslims in America, but I'll skip to the strategies and then we can kind of come back to that in the Q&A. Some of the strategies that we might think about when we're talking about minorities, when we're talking about racial and other minorities in the election cycle, and I, of course, have been thinking about this in the context, especially of Muslim Americans, are how we tend to, as Wendy Brown has said eloquently in her book on tolerance, or intolerance, really, is we tend to have culture and culture has them. So what we often do with minorities is we hold them to racial and cultural categories in which all things that minorities end up doing is a cause of their race, ethnicity, gender, religion, or whatever else it is. So I want to offer that, like Mamdani, that we not just take cultural or culturalization politics of what should be politicized, but rather we look at the socio-political, historical, economic, military context in which minorities often have to act, rather than looking at their culture and religion or theology, or in this case, not all things that Muslims do is because of Islam. Muslims might be acting on various other identities, intersectional identity. I always share that a lot of my critique of American, critique's a good thing, it's patriotic, I guess, but I can say that as a non-American. But a lot of my critiques of America often come from, not from being Muslim, which people assume, but maybe it's because I'm a Canadian, or maybe it's because I'm an anthropologist, right? It's not always because of Islam, it's not the totalizing factor in everything one says or does as a Muslim. The second is, again, to look at this intersectional identities in socio-political economic terms, but to also Americanize and globalize the problem. So again, when Muslims are doing things, don't just Islamicize it, Americanize the problem. Look at it from the perspective of the conditions in which people act, rather than focusing in on the problem with the minority, her or himself, right? Which brings me to my next point, which is to not ask minorities to do all the answering, but to actually ask majorities to question majorities of the conditions in which they have created, in which minorities find themselves. So minorities are not doubly victimized. In the case of Muslims mainstreaming us, right, so that you don't just have Muslims on TV or on Sproul Plaza just talking about what it is to be Muslim or talking about Islam or Islamophobia, but that you have a Muslim who just happens to have expertise in health care or in education, right? So you get Muslims who are then mainstreamed and not just tied to their identity as Muslims or just tied to Islam. Another strategy might be reversals, to see ourselves as others might see us. I don't know if some of you have seen this spoof on BBC where they show how Africans are thinking about us, what they're thinking about us as Americans. Usually we turn to sort of African countries and so-called less developed countries as a place where we cite, you know, injustices, lack of democracy, sexual assault, voter rigging, and of course they're seeing all of that happen in the U.S. So there's a sense that when we need to look at ourselves as well, rather than always having this kind of savior complex where sort of that's just happening elsewhere. And part of, I just want to end with a couple of notes from George Lakoff. Part of this national script that we're talking about is so present, you know, the script of how we belong and where we belong in the national imaginary is it's so scripted. We have basically a two-party system here, right? We have very little choice in that matter. So even the choices that we do think we're all free to make, in fact, we have very few choices. So one of the things is, in fact, to reframe the various scripts there are. And I'll just end with George Lakoff, his work on reframing social change, and it's from his book, Don't Think of an Elephant. And of course, when you say don't think of an elephant, you immediately think of an elephant. He says, frames are mental structures that shape the way we see the world. As a result, they shape the goals we seek, the plans we make, the way we act, and what counts as good or bad outcome of our actions. In politics, our frames shape our social policies and the institutions we form to carry out policies. To change our frame is to change all of this. Reframing is social change. You can't see or hear frames. They are part of what cognitive scientists call the cognitive unconscious, structures in our brains that we cannot consciously access, but know by their consequences, the way we reason and what counts as common sense. We also know frames through language. All words are defined relative to conceptual frames. When you hear a word, its frame or collection of frames is activated in your brain. Reframing is changing the way the public sees the world. It is changing what counts as common sense. Because language activates frames, new language is required for new frames. thinking differently requires speaking differently. And maybe on that note, I would just say, you know, this idea that all minorities and Muslim ones just presently have to just go through this because every minority has had to go through what I would call, you know, the hazing rituals of this frat club we call America, right? That everyone just has to go through these rituals, right? It's a reminder to say first that African-American Muslims, by the way, have already been through this, so I don't think Muslims have to go through this again. But it really raises the ethical question of if this is equal opportunity oppression and that everyone just has to go through it, when do we change that in America, where we recognize that the next minority should not have to go through these hazing and demeaning rituals? Thank you.
I'm going to ask Rabab Abdul Hadi from San Francisco State University, Arab and Muslim ethnicities and diaspora. San Francisco State University Ethnic Studies, School of Ethnic Studies, is the only school nationally, and it also was founded as a result of student protests, the longest standing student strike in the history of the United States. So again, don't underestimate the power of students. I know that you're only looking for an A, but at one point you were actually creating departments and institutions. So Rabab Abdul Hadi.
About that we don't have time to go to. In Nakab, inside Israel, in a Palestinian Bedouin community, Israel is taking more and more land that is left for that community. There's 40 communities that remain unrecognized, which means in Israeli government context, these communities don't have water, don't have electricity, don't have sewage, don't have education, don't have any resources whatsoever. In March of this year, the delegation, the 2016 U.S. prisoner, labor, and academic delegation visited Umm al-Hiran village in the Naqab, and the Umm al-Hiran village is being threatened by being destroyed. In its place, Israel wants to build a settlement inside Israel called Hiran, funded by money from the Jewish National Fund and U.S. tax dollars. And these are Israeli citizens. We also visited a village called Ain Hod, which is a Palestinian village that has been taken over. It's not one of the 531 villages that were destroyed in 1948. This village was remained, and it was turned into an Israeli artist colony, in which Israeli artists say that this is Palestinians do not appreciate history and do not appreciate their architecture and their culture, and therefore Israeli artists moved in and took over the village. Palestinian citizens in Israel are not given permits to build their homes. They have to actually, some of them have to destroy their homes, paying $100,000 for police dogs, Israeli police dogs and helicopters to destroy their own homes because it will cost more if Israel does it. In the old city of Hebron, where an American Jewish doctor from Brooklyn, Baruch Goldstein, went and killed 29 Palestinian worshippers in the Ibrahimi Mosque in 1994. The Israeli authorities' response has been to close the Palestinian Shuhada Street, a thoroughfare of 2,000 shops in the livelihood, turn a thriving city into a ghost city, and call the square Baruch Goldstein Square. Palestinian shopkeepers have to build horizontal checkpoints in order to protect themselves from the feces and the urine the settlers throw at them. You may also know, you know about what's going on with black youth in the cities, what's youth of color that are being killed by the police day in and day out. And some of you may think about what happened to Mohammed al-Ukhdir, the Palestinian kid, right before the Israeli invasion of Gaza, who was made to drink petrol and set on fire while he was alive. In Jerusalem itself, the municipal authority of Jerusalem, headed by a mayor that San Francisco State hosted in April, is trying to eliminate the number of Palestinians from 38% to 8% by taking away IDs, by expelling people, by depriving them, by moving settlers into their homes. I'm saying all of this also to remember that tomorrow, November 2nd, is actually the 99th anniversary of something called the Balfour Declaration. And this is the promise given by the British Foreign Minister, colonial authorities, to the Zionist movement to build a colonial homeland in Palestine. And the subsequent things that has happened. We talked about that in the class before, we can discuss it later. So what do the candidates, what do the electoral campaigns say about that? And what do we do as a result? Come November 9th, what do we do? Do we just go home? Do we get demoralized? Do we get depressed if our candidate doesn't win? Or I want to first say that I actually don't think I agree. I don't think there is anything that is really real democracy, participatory democracy, given the electoral campaigns. So, but people have discussed that. But how does Palestine work in the American, U.S. electoral American imaginary? Specifically for the two main contenders of the electoral elections, because a lot of people say lesser evil theory and so on, which we can discuss that. And we do know that in terms of the whole question of lack of participatory democracy, there is the surveillance, there is the witch hunt, there is the torture. We know from WikiLeaks and Snowden, students don't know, we can have a discussion about it, but I think a lot of people know, from the war on terror, from the intervention. These are things that are happening every single day, whether they are happening, quote-unquote, foreign policy of the United States, what they're happening here in the United States. So how is Israel presented? How is Palestine presented? Whose situation is presented? And people say there is nothing about the Middle East in the U.S. elections. They say there is nothing going on. It's very interesting because I went and looked at the electoral, the the campaigns, the two platforms, or the main ones. I'm not talking about Jill Stein, I'm not talking about all the revolutionary radical candidates who are intervening to have basically an interjection into the elections and have discussion of the issues that are not getting discussed. And it's very interesting. People say that it's not being mentioned, but what, because it is imagined as part and parcel of US policy. So it's not actually seen. When people think about what is foreign and what is domestic, the American imaginary does not contemplate Israel as something that belongs to the foreign imaginary. Weapons to Saudi Arabia, or my own case, that constitute that. Relations with other parts of the world constitute that. But when you talk about Israel, it's actually seen as part and parcel of everyday US imaginary. And this is why people don't think about it. They say, oh, nobody's talking about it. Actually, they are talking about it. It's part, very much part of the platforms of the two candidates. Very much taken for granted. So Israel, in both platforms, must remain protected and unconditionally supported. This is Obama, before he leaves office, he signed $38 billion package to Israel. And I should just, I would be remiss not to say that, to assuage my critique of Obama, describing the Israeli President Shimon Peres, who had passed, as the Mandela, which was such a huge insult to Mandela, and just such a huge insult to somebody who started the Israeli nuclear industry, who actually collaborated with South Africa and wasn't very much part of that, and who started the settlements, and who actually was one of the people who was day in and day out engaged in war, including the massacre in Qana in the south of Lebanon. So for to be called Mandela, I don't know where this is coming from, especially if somebody who's leaving office, but we can have a conversation about it. But Israel is always presented, Israel's security is always presented as a must part of US quote-unquote domestic policy, something that is every day. Nobody talks about security for the Palestinians. And the package, the military package, is constructed as defense, not as war industries. And there is, they're talking about the Arrowhead, the David Sling, the Iron Dome, and so on and so forth. But Trump is very much for, because Jerusalem is the eternal capital of Israel, and doesn't think that there is occupation. There is no occupation, doesn't exist. In terms of their other policies, Trump is very much part of it. He does fall on Cold War politics, but he replaces communism with radical Islam and uses the same doctrine of Reagan, calling the evil empire, the communism now, he's talking about the same kind of language. But he also employs something very interesting, the isolationist politics of Goldwater. So that's also happening. And it's also, there is racism that's involved that also recalls Theodore Roosevelt, and the Theodore Roosevelt who was talking about race suicide and called on white women to have more children, so there won't be too many people of color in the world. And also it employs the xenophobic and anti-immigrant 19th century and early 20th century, including even up to FDR, who imposed quotas on Jewish immigration and closed the doors in the face of survivors of the Nazi concentration camps. It's very interesting also how they employ gender and sexuality. I was going to talk a little bit about Khan, but I'm not going to talk about the Khan, I'm going to talk about Mrs. Khan. Before we talk about that, it's very interesting how Trump says, we're not going to intervene in the affairs of other countries, but we are going to move into rescue Muslim women, because who are being prosecuted by their men. And it's very interesting that he actually says about that, he's the last person who can talk about that. Right? But, of course, have no shame, do whatever you want. With Clinton, it's very interesting, the neocon policy and the agenda that she has, because a lot of people say, well, you know, she's much more liberal, she's much more liberal. But this is a neoliberal political agenda that's in economic terms, internally and externally. But also Clinton also employs colonial feminism and pink washing to deploy US military intervention. This is where it becomes very interesting what happened to Mrs. Khan in particular, not Mr. Khan, because Mrs. Khan didn't speak. So what did Trump say? He says that, oh, they won't let her speak. Because she's a... So what was the response of the Democrats? She was too shook up emotionally to speak. Think about the ways in which the Muslim woman is being imagined now. And this is, and I actually think it's very problematic in the ways in which the military gets glorified and military intervention gets... And then it gets to the point where you can't even critique it. becomes sort of closed public space that you can even have a discussion about that. Clinton is very much an interventionist. It's exactly the way Bill Clinton did in Bosnia and elsewhere. She does advocate, and she will implement the doctrine of regime change, exactly as Richard Perle and Paul Wolfowitz did in Iraq and Libya and elsewhere, and now they want to implement that for Syria. She also, and which is relevant to us and to on campus, is she did speak in her APAC, in her speech to the American Israeli Public Affairs Committee. She referred to a letter that she sent to the presidents of major Jewish organizations, which she said, we have to be united in fighting back against BDS. This is very relevant to our campus. She also told college students, and I quote, don't let anyone silence you or bully you. Don't let anyone silence you or bully you or try to shut down debate, especially in places of learning like colleges and universities. I hope you stay strong. Keep speaking out. How does this work in our case? We are in the business of production of knowledge, right? This is why we are at a university. This is what we do. We don't do anything else. We produce knowledge. What sort of knowledge do we produce? And what is going on? So I want to just give you a few, and then so we can have more time for...
I can have time.
Okay. So I want to just talk about some of what do people who produce knowledge do. So one of the examples that some of you may know, there's Israeli professor's name is Mordechai Kader. Some of you may know. He is a professor at Bar-Ilan University in Israel, who actually called for the rape of Palestinian women and sisters in order to teach Palestinians a lesson. He actually called for that publicly. Last spring, last academic year, Hunter College of the City University of New York invited him to come and speak. And just as your activism here and our activism reinstated the DECAL course on Palestine, the efforts by the faculty, the staff, the students, and community made Hunter force Hunter College to rescind the invitation to him. This didn't happen at San Francisco State. San Francisco State last spring hosted Nir Barakat. Nir Barakat is the mayor of occupied Jerusalem. He came to speak about the diversity and tech industries, how there's going to be collaboration because Jerusalem is very diverse, very great camp. And this is a guy who actually slings a machine gun and goes in the streets of Jerusalem and calls for killing the Arabs. He's caught on video doing that. The students at San Francisco State protested, a whole big coalition of students, both Palestinian students and other students from Skin Student Council for the Arab Nations, Black Student Union, Mecha, Rasa, League of Philippine Students, all the students went together and protested as students, not as organized groups. And what happened is that San Francisco State actually put them through what is called student conduct hearing based on something called time, place, and manner, a policy that has never been implemented anywhere. Because this Palestinian student held a megaphone, a little megaphone, bulhor, in which they were chanting. At the same time, there have been several instances where there have been big sound systems on university quad. And we are not, by the way, advocating for policing any student activities. We think students are, this is the time that they can organize and do whatever they want. But this has been, and San Francisco State acknowledged that this was the only time and the first time they carried out this policy. The two student, young students, female students, were bullied. Their faces were placed on Canary Mission. They received death threats. They received threats of rape. Their jobs were called to ask for them to be fired. The university did not provide protection for them. Instead, it persecuted them. And the president of our university wrote an opinion page in JWeekly.edu in which he called them mayor of Jerusalem to apologize to him even after he knew what this guy stood for and re-invited him back to campus. You would wonder why is the case, it's just influences. This is the corporate university, which we can talk about that in terms of economic terms. More recently, we were also, a lot of us were targeted by David Horowitz and the Canary Mission, blastering everywhere and actually accusing us of engaging in Jew hatred. This is a very serious charge. Anti-Semitism is a hate crime. Some, the people who know us know that this is not what we engage in. But to have your picture blasted, this is an incitement to violence. This is racist, this is Islamophobic, this is violent, this is bullying, but this is an incitement to violence as well. What are our universities doing about that? What are they doing in order to protect the students? And where does this come from? Why is this going on? Why are these attacks happening? In 2010, there was something called the Reut Institute in Israel that came up with a report saying that Palestinian activism for justice in for Palestine is increasing on college campuses. And that there needs to be something done in order to confront what they call the delegitimization network. This is the delegitimization network of Israeli policies on campuses. They come up with several proposals. They didn't, and this is, by the way, 2010, this was because 2008, 2009, Israel attacked Gaza. And in 2010, there was a ship called Navi Marmara, which Israeli authorities attacked and killed the people, 9 people on the ship, and there was an international outro. So the Reut Institute came out and said, these are the recommendations. It took a few years, basically because there is much more support. And I, as I said earlier in the class, and I would say here, is that what is happening is that people in the United States are joining the world. The world community is actually stands for justice in for Palestine. It's not analytical, it's not an exceptional thing. The United States, when people stand here, they say, oh, you're so courageous because you advocate for justice for Palestine. We say, we're just part of the world community. It's just not really unusual. This is something here that is going on. For the pro-Israeli apologists, it is unacceptable. It is unacceptable for anybody to speak for justice in for Palestine. So the question for them is not to actually have debate. The question is not to allow any debate to happen. We go back to Hillary Clinton's words. Speak up. Don't let them shut you down. And part of this is also, I should say, this is part of a very organized, very well-financed campaign. This is not a couple of grassroots organizations that are going around. This is a group that is funded by Sheldon Adelson, who is in the Las Vegas casino mogul, multi-billionaire, the Koch brothers, and other, as well as by the Israeli government, whose ministers in March called for civic assassination of leaders and advocates of boycott, divestment, and sanctions. The reason this is happening is because people are making advances, because there is a lot of people, more and more people, the polls of the youth in the United States are saying, we are more and more for justice and for Palestine. Jewish youth, polls and polls among Jewish youth are saying the same thing. And of course, we know about black youth, indigenous youth, and Asian American, Latino. This has been going on for a while in labor movement, in Paris, in all sorts of academic places. I don't need to share with you all of that. That's all there. So there is a lot of advances that are going on, and this is something that is unacceptable by these groups. So what do we do in the face of something of this sort? What do we do in the face of what's happening at San Francisco State? What do we do in the face of what's going on here at Berkeley? What are the choices do we have? What do we do on November 9th? Is November 9th the point at which we just back up? If it is a democratic president, the movement somehow goes to sleep for 8 years until a Republican goes into the White House. And if it's a Republican president, everybody starts organizing, getting so horrified or gets completely demoralized. When Reagan got elected in 1980, the movement waited. He destroyed the PATCO airline controllers. Airport controls, yeah, PATCO, the union. Then he went against the women's movement. Then he moved against the movements in Central America, El Salvador and Nicaragua. He moved against the Palestinians because he actually failed. They failed. His government failed to attack the Committee in Solidarity with the people of El Salvador. So they felt the Palestinians would be the weakest thing. They went after and they destroyed the movement after another. This is a history. This is not part of the repression against advocates for Palestine is not exceptional. It's really important to keep that in mind. The U.S. is not exceptional. There is no such thing as the American miracle or the Israeli miracle or that there is an exceptionality of Palestine. This is part and parcel of the history of repression of this country. And maybe some of my colleagues have spoken about that. Some of it goes back, and I know Evie spoke about the concentration camps of the Japanese during the Second World War. There is the bombing raids at the turn of the 20th century. There is the attack, the harassment of union officials. There is the deportation of the anarchists like Emma Goldman and other people who were organizing the U.S. There is the McCarthyist, the House on Un-American Activities. And actually, this whole Un-American and American is a very interesting way to think about that. What does this mean? And the American imaginary during McCarthyism. So this is something, and then it goes into the 60s, and I'm sure one of my colleagues spoke about the COINTELPRO program, the counterintelligence program against the Black Panthers, American Indian movement, Brown Berets, the Puerto Rican movement, and so on and so forth. And you continue, and so this is the attack against all the movements in the 80s during Reagan did not come out of a vacuum. They were very much part and parcel of the ways in which the government of this country functions. If you go back to J. Edgar Force and you continue, this is going on. So what happens on November 9th? What happens on November 9th? Do we just pack up our bags? Do we get demoralized? Or do we, from now or before, we organize in order for us to actually stop these policies from destroying our lives, wherever they are? And where we are here, we are on campuses, we are the producers of knowledge. So our first task is to produce knowledge and to produce critical knowledge and let all the students and our colleagues and everybody not to let us be silenced, to speak together and to construct the questions, whether you're talking about quote-unquote foreign policy, whether you're talking about Palestine, whether you're talking about the prison industrial complex or Standing Rock or anything that is happening here on campus as part and parcel of the indivisibility of justice, not to advocate for one kind of justice at the expense of another, not to accept that it is okay to get some liberalized but not to get everything else. It is not okay. We do deserve better and we can make it better, but we really need to start organizing yesterday before tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob, for both getting us ready for November 9th, and I guess we need to mobilize ahead of time. I think when Clinton ran, I organized the first protest against him when he was running. And the Democratic Committee in San Francisco was up in arms because he was our savior. And we were organizing against NAFTA between Canada, the United States, and Mexico. We had a conference in Guadalajara between the three countries, and people were just so in love with Clinton. And I said at the time that Clinton, as soon as he's gonna get into power, he's gonna approve NAFTA. And that's basically what happened. He stuck it to the union. And the Democratic Party in Congress basically rolled up and played dead for Clinton. So again, the political landscape, we have to be aware that when it comes to communities of color, you have to really look for how to assert the strategic interest for the communities, regardless of what political parties and go with your set of priorities. I wanted actually to give my talk, but I want to shrink it a little bit. I wanted actually to speak about Trumpism, and I actually labeled it as racist eggs and fascist omelets, because that's basically what we have today. And I said that over the past year and a half, Trump has managed to awaken a new America's racist, a phenomenon that would be a stay around past the November elections, and the impact would be far-reaching and complex. Racists, as we see, have emerged out of the woodworks and from deep down in the cellars due to a presidential candidate that is at ease with carrying their message to every corner of the country and making bigotry sound patriotic and in vogue again. Racists becoming vogue and having front coverage, including ABC and other major outlets having interviews with the KKK. The Klan is mainstream in the discourse, and that should be a concern to everyone. The current racist wave is nothing new in American history, since a quick look back gets us to the Chinese Exclusionary Act, Japanese internment, and the Civil Rights period, just to name a few, which taken together illustrate the constant entanglement and centrality of race in political discourses. The outcome of the presidential election is still to be decided, but what is certain is that Trump's racist campaign will cast a deep shadow on political discourses in the country for years to come.
Trump, the candidate, has given birth to Trumpism, a brand of political discourse that is rooted in fear, xenophobia, expanded, quote, mistrust of government, and at the same time, highly and bombastically racist. We can for sure say that Trump has managed to hatch a new crop of America's racist eggs, and is comfortable cooking fascist omelet to jubilant and frenzied crowd nationally. What does Trumpism mean for the country and how it's different than before are important questions for all of us. Trump, the candidate, managed to infuse the 2016 elections with an ugly dose of racist form of nativism, xenophobia, and populism, and populism that attracted droves of disaffected, marginalized, and stoked working class and poor whites. Certainly a large segment of whites who live in the middle of the country have been left behind in the rapidly changing economy, and political elites from both parties have not addressed the issues arising from this rapid transformation. Agriculture and manufacturing jobs have been obliterated across many parts of the country, and no solid plans were put in place to mitigate or address the fallout. Furthermore, corporate elites who shifted blue-collar jobs offshore got rewarded by government regulations, or more accurately, deregulations, that allowed massive shifts of wealth upward from the poor and middle class into the coffers of the 1%. The rich got richer, Trump included, while the poor got dispossessed and left out on the streets to fetch for themselves many times over. The poor and middle class whites have historically depended on farms, agriculture, and stable blue-collar manufacturing jobs, which allowed them to live and prosper for generations. Financial deregulations, pernicious globalizations, free trade agreements, and the emergence of the technology sector translated into an economic scorched earth across many parts of America, and with it, structural undoing of social cohesion and stability for a sizable segment of whites and African American as well. But they are not the focus of this speech at this point. Stable jobs left the country, never come back, but the people who held these jobs got promised by politicians, and these promises were never kept or intended to be pursued from the get-go by these politicians who show up once every 4 years or 2 years for Congress. What working class whites face is a transformation that they were ill-prepared for and have not been conditioned to accept by people of color. In reality, poor and working class whites have joined communities of color by becoming economically, socially, and politically marginalized, a condition that was never contemplated for themselves since they all along believed that they were living the American dream. Starting in the middle 1970s, poor and working class whites and communities of color have witnessed a steady decline in their real income, meaning income adjusted for inflation, shrinking of their wealth, narrowing of opportunities, and heavy level of indebtedness, including students today. No one can dispute the damage and pain that is felt across many parts of the country, and more so in the middle sections of the United States, which on the one hand has not benefited from the shifts in the economy, and on the other, faces a prolonged and deepening structural recession. Who to blame for destroying America's middle and working class communities and shifting of jobs abroad? This is the important question which gets lost in the political campaign, since each party posits itself as a friend of America's working class and communities of color in the hope of securing votes and seats of power. The blame game is an easy way to shift responsibility and score points in the ever-present electoral cycle. Let's be clear that both political parties bear responsibility for the carnage that once was a vibrant middle class and working class, where a person could work to support a family and look forward to a good pension come retirement time. This is no longer a possibility for many across the country. Corporate elites, narrow financial interests, and globalization raiders are wedded into spineless and self-absorbed political elites of both parties that pursue economic policies benefiting the top 1% and at the expense of the overwhelming majority of the population inside the United States and also in the Southern Hemisphere. What we have is trickle-up economics, which managed to empty the pockets of the poor and the middle class, and seamlessly made it flow into the coffers of the obscenely rich, while not leaving behind crumbs to mitigate the wholesale institutional daylight robberies for the rest of the population. Trump represents that type of economic discourse. It is in the above context that Trumpism has been born and builds a distorted and fictitious picture of responsibility and blame for what went wrong in today's America, and offer it as a campaign theme. Yes, Trump points at Mexican immigrants, Muslims, Chinese, and African Americans, and Asian Americans as the source of America's economic problems, while forgetting to include himself and all those who benefited at the top. Here we have a tax dodging, bankruptcy scheming, touching women private parts, stifling college debts, worthless degree granting, foreign steel importing, jobs outsourcing, manufacturing closed in China, and people of color evicting. Trump is offering himself as a rescuer of America's middle class and the poor, as if the list that I have enumerated is not enough to disqualify him from even being in any civic engagement, including possibly being invited to a library just to be around people of decent background. The joke is on all of those who have drunk the Kool-Aid and accepted to blame the Mexicans, Blacks, Latinos, Asians, Muslims, and China for all the ills that have been making that have been in the making for a long time. Trump skillfully used a brand of venomous populism that, on the one hand, correctly attacked the political establishment in Washington for failures to address the concerns of the working class, but on the other, unleashed a torrent of racist attacks on immigrant Blacks, Muslim, Chinese, and anyone that is not white, and those communities that are doubly marginalized in the country. On a daily basis, and from day one, Trump unleashed one racist salvo after another in an attempt to win the Republican nomination by appealing to the most extreme, reactionary, xenophobic segments of the white working class and poor communities. The campaign stitched together a coalition that consisted of a toxic mix of conspiracy theorists, anti-immigrant and anti-monarchy groups, and militant whites, which managed to win the Republican nomination. In the process, Trump became the flag bearer for the new brand of politics that we must call Trumpism. The know-nothing party of the 19th century has a new lease on life. It is called Trump. And it has a populist demagogue that is using racism, xenophobia, and Islamophobia, and anti-immigrant rhetoric in the hope of gaining a seat of power. Let us be clear. Even if Trump loses the election, Trumpism is far from being defeated and will need a robust political and economic program from all of us to undo its effects. The work of undoing Trumpism will begin November 9th, regardless who makes it to the White House. Thank you.